डायरेक्टली मार्क तो ना रात में तो इतना टाइम बहुत है अबे इतना टाइम बस
Very good morning, my dear students. I am Dr. Wadbaker from Biochemistry Department of BLD Medical College. Yesterday, means the last class, we had discussed about the TCA cycle, which is the another pathway for the metabolism of carbohydrates, similar to the glycolysis. It has also got about 8 steps of reactions wherein there will be the formation of the substrates or substrates involving in the reactions which they lead to the formation of some products, and which those products will be a starting material for some of the things which you have seen that one. And also you have seen that one, it is a reactions which is happening in a cyclic one, or you can call that as a hub of the metabolism, as it is the one where the end products of the other different metabolites are getting converted and giving rise to the other products, like the metabolism of the fats, or it may be regarding the protein and also including the carbohydrates. So all these things, one, they get a common platform in the form of acetyl-CoA, which will be dealt further after the liberation of the carbon dioxide and the water molecule along with the ATP. So today we are dealing with the another pathway, metabolic pathway, that is gluconeogenesis. The thing is that when there is the break or unavailability of supply of the carbohydrates through the diet, then the body has to get dependent on the other pathway, so that there should be a continuous supply of the sugar or the glucose to the certain parts of our body, like the brain, erythrocytes, like that one. So in order to provide the glucose to the body has adopted a method called as the gluconeogenesis. So when you define the gluconeogenesis, we are seeing that one, if the definition is that the formation of glucose from the non-carbohydrate products, initially it will be depending upon the fat storage is there. From that one, the breaking of the glucose will take place, and then after the longer starvation period or unavailability of the carbohydrates, the body will start breaking up of the proteins or the amino acids, from where there will be the supply of the sugar or the glucose to the body. So today we'll deal with the gluconeogenesis. So it is the synthesis of the glucose or the glycogen from the non-carbohydrate things, that may be the fats, amino acids. So what happens in the glycolysis? Glucose is synthesized from the pyruvate. Similarly, glucose will be synthesized from the pyruvate, which will be derived from the TCA or the glycerol in the form of the intermediate products. And in the glycolysis, there can be the formation of lactate also, that which takes place in the anaerobic condition. So the pyruvate can be formed from the lactate by the reversal of the lactate dehydrogenase reaction. So in these things, when there is non-supply of the direct glucose, the body will adopt to this methodology or the pathways which will be having the source of the fats and amino acids. What is the need of this gluconeogenesis in the body? The need is that one, that it has to be supplied to the certain tissues for the special purposes. That is, there should be a continuous supply of the energy, and there should be a continuous source of the energy for the central nervous system, brain, testes, kidney. And what happens during the starvation, this pathway, that is gluconeogenesis, it attempts to maintain the blood glucose level within the normal range. So for the 12 to 18 hours, body will be depending upon the storage form of the glucose, that is glycogen, it will be depending on that one, and that will be depleted and it will be consuming that glucose and supplying it to the essential tissues like the CNS or the brain and other things. But after the long prolonged starvation, gluconeogenesis will be speeded up and protein will be taken to the task for the catabolism, and it will be depending upon some amino acids where therein the carbohydrate or sorry the glucose can be supplied to the these essential things where they are depending upon the glucose, that is the brain or testes or the CNS system. So when you look at this pathway of the gluconeogenesis, you must be seeing that, or you may just be thinking of that, if they are the things exactly how they are in the path of the glycolysis, how in the glycolysis glucose will be converted into the glucose 6-phosphate, fructose 6-phosphate, so fructose 6-phosphate, like that one, it will form directly into the pyruvate undergoing about 10 reactions. So one can claim or try to say that one, that this gluconeogenesis is exactly reversal of the glycolysis. No, it is not that way, because the glycolysis pathway, it has got the three stages or the three steps where the reaction is irreversible one. All these things, about other 7 reactions are reversible, whereas the 3 reactions are irreversible one. So we cannot claim that it is the exactly opposite of the glycolysis. So you can see here the final product, that pyruvate that will be formed in the glycolysis, that is the pyruvate is the starting material in the gluconeogenesis. It will get converted into the oxaloacetate. But what this happens, this oxaloacetate is impermeable to the cell membrane. So it has to undergo some changes and it will be converted into the malate, and then from malate to it will be reconverted to oxaloacetate and it will follow the reactions. So how that will do that one, we'll see in the next slides. And another thing, from this gluconeogenesis, you must be seeing that one, there are some other things can be forming there, that is of the alpha ketoacid that will be coming in the TCA cycle, so that these intermediates are also helping for the continuation of this gluconeogenesis. So remember that it may be appearing or seeming that it is the same reactions are taking place, just in a opposite way from the way it is the reactions are going in the glycolysis. No, it is, though they are all the reactions are similar, and the two things are that one is that it is regulated, glycolysis reactions are regulated at 3 positions which are irreversible one, and also at the starting point the oxalate as exact, it will not get passed through that further cell membrane and get into the reactions, because it will be impermeable. We'll see in the next slide. First thing, the gluconeogenesis, it closely resembles the reverse pathway of the glycolysis. So the end product aerobic glycolysis is pyruvate, but glucose cannot be produced by reversing the process, as there are 3 irreversible reactions. So it is sharing about the 7 irreversible reversible reactions and 3 irreversible reactions. You may be remembering that those steps of the glycolysis are catalyzed at the steps of 3 enzymes. They are hexokinase or the glucokinase, and phosphofructokinase, and pyruvate kinase. These are the 3 name of the 3 react enzymatic reactions wherein it will be checked or regulated for the in the case of glycolysis. So this one and conversion of oxaloacetate, these are the one which are not possible with the glycolysis. So it is not exactly opposite or reversible pathway of the glycolysis. So very first one, that is, I'll show you the reaction also. This pyruvate in presence of ATP, it undergoes the carboxylation and it forms into the oxaloacetate with the conversion of ATP into the ATP and formation of one phosphate group. That is the first reaction. By the action of this pyruvate carboxylase, it is the enzyme, in presence of biotin, ATP and carbon dioxide, it converts that pyruvate to the oxalate. You can see here, it is getting into the conversion of oxaloacetate. This is the first reaction. So this oxaloacetate, that is, it is impermeable to the inner mitochondrial membrane, so that it cannot enter into the cytosol. It cannot enter into the cytosol. So what happens in the form of the malate, which is permeable to the mitochondria, it can enter into the cytosol. So remember here, in the first step of the reaction, pyruvate carboxylase is the enzyme which converts the pyruvate, that is the last product what it is in the glycolysis, that one gets converted into the oxaloacetate. But this oxaloacetate is impermeable for the inner side of the mitochondrial membrane. So what happens, this oxaloacetate, it has to get converted into the malate. So that conversion will take place in the presence of mitochondrial. Malate dehydrogen is the one enzyme. This is the enzyme which converts this oxaloacetate by the mode of oxidation into the malate. So oxaloacetate is converted into the malate. Now this malate, whatever is formed, it is just reconverted. It is reconverted into the oxaloacetate in the presence of malate, cytosolic malate dehydrogenase by the process of reduction. So the, now this can be having the entrance, or it may be having the permeability for the entry for the cytosol. So malate dehydrogenase of the TCA cycle, that converts the oxaloacetate to the malate. So this malate again is reconverting that the malate into the oxaloacetate will be converted by this cytosolic malate dehydrogenase by the reduction method. Now, so whatever the amount of the malate is formed, that is diffusing out of this cytosol, and malate is reconverted to oxaloacetate by this one. So in the second step, the one another enzyme, that is phosphoenol pyruvate cytocarboxykinase, it converts the oxaloacetate into the phosphoenol pyruvate. You can see here, this gets converted, whatever the oxaloacetate is formed from the malate, it is getting converted into the phosphoenol pyruvate by the method of this decarboxylation in the presence of enzyme phosphoenol pyruvate carboxykinase. So this enzyme converts this oxaloacetate, which has been formed from the malate, which malate is formed in the presence of this malate dehydrogenase when it is combined with the oxaloacetate. So this is how this phosphoenol pyruvate is formed. So there will be the one thing to be remembered, that for this all phosphorylation, there is the need of one GTP for the production of phosphate is required here. In the gluconeogenesis, there will be consumption of the energy, and simultaneously carbon dioxide gets liberated. Now just a flowchart also will be here. You can see here from pyruvate to oxaloacetate, it is pyruvate carboxylase, it forms this oxalate which is impermeable in the cell membrane. It gets converted into the malate, and from malate to reconverted the oxaloacetate. From oxaloacetate it forms into the PEP, that is phosphoenol pyrophosphate. It is in the presence of PEP carboxylic kinase, and then the reaction continues here. So second, this one also is there. These are all almost similar in the reversal way what you find in the metabolism of carbohydrate or the glucose, you can say, in the pathway called as the glycolysis. So this is the difference between the glycolysis and the gluconeogenesis, where it can be assumed that it is the reversal of the glycolysis, but these are the some changes which can you find at the start of the reaction, where this oxaloacetate will be converted into malate, malate to hexane, oxaloacetate, and then into the regular reactions. In the glycolysis, the glycolysis is regulated at another two steps, which are the irreversible one. Now the later the reactions move into the reverse way further, till the step of the formation of fructose 6-phosphate after the hydrolysis by the enzyme 1,6-bisphosphate. You can see here 1,6-bisphosphate, it will be converted into the fructose 6-phosphate, and then here this reaction, it requires the magnesium ions, and it is absent in the smooth muscle and heart muscle. This enzyme is not available in the smooth muscle and heart muscle. Now finally what happens, once the fructose 6-phosphate is formed, that is once the fructose 6-phosphate is formed, that is converted into the glucose 6-phosphate, and then in presence of glucose 6-phosphatase, it is converted into the final product, that is glucose. So fructose 6-phosphate converted into glucose 6-phosphate by the glucophosphoisomerase, and then into the glucose. And another thing is that it is the glucose 6-phosphate which is present in the liver and kidney, but it is absent in the muscle, brain and the adipose tissue. This is something about the steps involved in the gluconeogenesis. The steps which are exactly what they are in the glycolysis, in the reverse way of the glycolysis steps, are found to be present in the metabolism of the glucose by the mode of gluconeogenesis. But at the three positions, it is not exactly as it is of the glycolysis, and the end product will be the glucose. However, it will be done within similar fashion in the reverse way of the methods or the steps adopted for the glycolysis. So what is the similarity or difference between the gluconeogenesis and glycolysis? The gluconeogenesis pathway is highly endergonic, means it is inside one only, and it is the one which is coupled with the hydrolysis of ATP or GTP. So here there will be consumption of the ATP will be there. So you can see here, from pyruvate to glucose 6-phosphate, it requires 4 molecules of the ATP and 2 molecules of the GTP to proceed spontaneously. These ATPs are supplied from the fatty acid catabolism via beta oxidation. So in the case of the lipid metabolism, you will come to know this, how this will be supplying these ATPs to this gluconeogenesis. So gluconeogenesis is the one which is consuming the ATP, means it is one which requires the spelling of the ATPs, whereas in the glycolysis, one cycle of this glycolysis yields about the ATP molecules. That means there will be production or the formation of the ATPs. This is the basic difference between the gluconeogenesis and glycolysis. So if a question is asked in the examination regarding the gluconeogenesis and glycolysis, you have to mention these points, that in the glycolysis, what the reaction pathway is there? It is to be in the reversal of the glycolysis in the gluconeogenesis. But at the three steps, it can be the one which is not exactly opposite of the reverse of the glycolysis. That is, one is the formation of the oxaloacetate, and another at the stage of using of these phosphokinase, PFK and pyruvate kinase, it is a regulatory mechanism where it is irreversible one. And third one is in the course of gluconeogenesis, it is used or it is continuing with the consumption of the ATP and GTP molecules. Whereas in the glycolysis, it is the one where there will be the formation of the ATP molecules. And these are available, are made available from the fatty acid catabolism via beta oxidation in the lipid metabolism. So you can see again, once again I have put it for you, are just seeing the things. It is exactly coming opposite as that of glycolysis, but the changes are there as I mentioned in the earlier slides. Now, coming to the another one aspect of this gluconeogenesis, that is Cury cycle, or it can be also referred with the word called as the lactic acid cycle. So the lactic acid or the lactate, it is formed in the anaerobic glycolysis, and it will be formed in the muscle which cannot be metabolized further. So once the lactate is formed in the muscle, it cannot be metabolized further. So hence, through the blood, what the body has got the system that it will be transported to the liver, which will be oxidized to the pyruvate. It will be transferred or converted into the pyruvate. This pyruvate is converted into the glucose by the gluconeogenesis, and it will be transferred to the muscle. You have followed it, that if the lactate is produced in the muscle from the course of anaerobic glycolysis situation, this cannot undergo further the metabolism. So what happens? Through the blood, this lactate will be transported to the liver, where it will be oxidized. It gets oxidized to the pyruvate. This pyruvate is converted into the glucose through the mechanism gluconeogenesis, and it will be transported to the muscle. So this reformed glucose, it becomes available for the energy purpose in the skeletal muscle. It will be made available for the skeletal muscle as the source of energy. So this cycling of this lactate between muscle and liver is referred as the Cury cycle or lactic acid cycle. The question may be asked regarding define Cury cycle, then you have to answer it. So in the next slide you will see that one, how it happens exactly. That in the muscle, whatever the lactate is formed, so that will not undergo further metabolism. This lactate is transported to the liver, where this lactate is converted into the pyruvate, and from pyruvate it through the process of gluconeogenesis it will be formed into the glucose 1, and this glucose will be transferred to the muscle back there, and then this muscle can use this glucose in the form of the energy for the other activities. So this is the circular or cycle of the conversion of lactate which has formed in the muscle through the mode of anaerobic condition. Muscle, from the muscle this lactate to the liver, from the lactate it is converted into the pyruvate, from pyruvate to the glucose, and then this glucose come back to the again muscle, which can be used as the energy. So significance of this one is that it prevents lactic acidosis in the muscle under the anaerobic condition, and this cycle is important in the producing of the ATP during the muscle activity. One another thing is that it works more sufficiently when the muscle activity is ceased. One, so this is the significance of this Cori cycle. Now another thing is that glucose alanine cycle, there is one more, is that during the starvation, after the depletion of the fat stores, these muscle proteins, they break down and release some amino acids for the energy purpose of the body, that is the one which is ultimately gluconeogenesis. In the later stage of the starvation, when there is the glycogen storage is not enough to meet the situation, then the depletion of stores of fat stores are also completed, then the body will look at the muscle proteins. These carbon skeletons of these amino acids, they are used to form the pyruvate. These are used for the formation of the pyruvate. This pyruvate, it undergoes transamination to produce the alanine, which is transported to liver, where it is used for the gluconeogenesis. Transamination means the transformation or the transfer of the amino group of an amino acid to the keto acid. This will be the one which you will come more within the metabolism of protein will be taught to you. So this is the process of the transamination. So during the transamination, this pyruvate will be forming or producing the alanine, which will be transported to the liver through the gluconeogenesis, and this process is referred as the glucose alanine cycle. You got it? During the starvation condition, the carbon skeletons of the amino acids are used to form the pyruvate. This pyruvate, it undergoes a transamination and they produce the alanine, which will be transported to the liver, where it is used for the gluconeogenesis. So this pathway is referred as the glucose alanine cycle. The main important part of this, are the significance of this glucose alanine cycle, is that it will help to maintain the nitrogen balance in the body, because the nitrogen balance is identified with the two things, that is positive nitrogen balance and negative nitrogen balance. Positive nitrogen balance is the one which will be indicating of the proper growth, or the growth that is taking place in the children and other things and good aspects, whereas the negative nitrogen balance means there is a wastage of the nitrogen will be there through the which is excreted through the urine, which may be indicating of the some diseases regarding to the kidneys. So the good nitrogen balance can be obtained by the this glucose alanine cycle. So here you can see that one, in the muscle, when the starvation is continued, that time this will be converted, or the alanine, whatever it has been formed from the pyruvate, from the lactate to pyruvate to the alanine, and this alanine is transferred from the amino group of the amino acids, and this alanine is passed on to the liver, where in liver this alanine is converted into the pyruvate, and from pyruvate to glucose through the gluconeogenesis, and this glucose is made available to the muscle in the form of the glucose. Now this regulation of the gluconeogenesis takes place at the two places, including of the four enzymes. These are the pyruvate carboxylase, phosphoenol carboxy kinase, fructose 1,6-phosphatase, and glucose 6-phosphatase. It is there. The hormone glucagon, you may be remembering that. The glucagon is the one which increases the blood glucose level, whereas the insulin is doing opposite to the glucagon, which suppresses or inhibits the level of the glucose in this one. So one is that which is regulated by these enzymes, glucagon and insulin, and second one is the pyruvate carboxylase is a allosteric enzyme which will be stimulated by the acetyl-CoA and inhibited by the ADP. Just I'll show in the next slide. That is, it is a allosteric enzyme, means it has got the, what it has got? It has got the sites apart from the place where the enzymatic reactions will be taking place, which will be referred as the active sites. So the enzymes having the other sites where the reactions may take place other than the active site, they are referred as the allosteric enzyme. So here, see, high levels of this acetyl-CoA, it activates the pyruvate carboxylase, and there will be the inhibition from conversion of this pyruvate to acetyl-CoA. And second one, this glucagon and the insulin are the one which regulates the gluconeogenesis. So these are the two points wherein this gluconeogenesis is getting regulated. So the importance or some points regarding the gluconeogenesis is that after the prolonged starvation, if the glycogen reserves are depleted, it becomes progressively more important, because there is essentiality of supply of the glucose or the glycogen to the brain and other things will be there. So when there is no supply of this glucose or glycogen is not there, then that time to supply this glucose and other things, the gluconeogenesis becomes more dependent one of other enzyme pathways. So it becomes more prominent that to be considered. And if because of the some other reasons, if this gluconeogenesis pathway is not working properly, or it is not in the good one, or because of some inherited disease conditions, so leading to the failure of gluconeogenesis, that will lead to the fatal condition. That is, the first will be the hypoglycemia will be there, and which causes the dysfunctioning of the brain, and finally the chances will be there the patient may go into the coma and the death. And gluconeogenesis, it mainly occurs in the liver with a small amount of the thing occurring in the kidney also. So it occurs very little in the brain, skeletal muscle and the heart muscle, which won't get supplied from the gluconeogenesis pathway. They have to be dependent on the gluconeogenesis, which will be taking place in the liver and the kidney to the small extent it is doing there, they have to be dependent on the gluconeogenesis which will be occurring at liver and kidney. And so the supply of the glucose may not be enough together to meet the demand of these organs, though it is taking place in these organs. So the pathway should be there consistently occurring in the liver to maintain the glucose level in the blood to meet these demands of the brain and the other erythrocytes or other things. Okay. Another thing is that alcoholism is the one which is associated with the hypoglycemia. Two things are there, that a person under the effect of alcohol, he may forget to consume the food properly. That may be the one. And another thing biologically is that alcohol is metabolized to acetate, and there will be production of high levels of NADH which will alter the glucogenic pathway. So these are the two things. Because of this one, the person who is alcoholic one, often he may found to be under the condition of hypoglycemia. So you must be seeing that one. They themselves say, or other people say, that don't remain starving, in the starving condition once you consume the alcohol. So one has to consume the food properly and after the intake of the alcohol. Now coming to the another pathway, that is glycogenesis. That is glycogenesis. What is glycogenesis? It is the one which is related to the stored form of the glucose, that is glycogen. A small amount of the glucose is stored in the body to provide the reserve supply to the use whenever the glucose doesn't enter the blood. Means whenever the food is taken, it is converted into the glucose after the metabolism, and some amount of that one will be reserved in the liver, and then adipose tissue later on. But this will be there to support the body functioning one. So that stored glucose one is referred as the glycogen. This glycogen is not a that much rich source of the energy as it is of the triglyceride. That is because the fatty acids, they occur in a very reduced form of the TG structure. So you are knowing well that one, the brain is the one which is in need of the glucose very constantly, and as if the fatty acids cannot cross the blood-brain barrier, so because of this reason, glucose is supposed to be the source of instant source of the energy. So this is something about the glycogen and why it should be stored. So this synthesis of the glycogen from the glucose, so the storing part of this glycogen, how it will be done or stored from the glucose, that pathway is called as the glycogenesis, and it requires ATP, UTP apart from the glucose molecule, and this will be stored in the liver and the muscle. At subcellular site, it is in the cytosol. Similarly, stored excess carbohydrates in the form of the glycogen, which can be broken to the glucose when needed, it is referred as the glycogenolysis. So remember well, there will be use of two words which are more similar to each other. One is glycogenesis and another one is glycogenolysis. Glycogenesis means synthesis of the glucose from the glucose, storing. it is called as the glycogenesis. When the stored carbohydrate, it is there, glycogenesis, if it is broken down and formed into the glucose, then that is, that pathway is referred as the glycogenolysis. So this liver content of the glycogen is greater than that of the muscle, because of the muscle mass of the muscle, the liver is the one which is has the capacity to store the liver, sorry, glucose in the more amount than the muscle. And muscle glycogen, it provides a ready availability of the source of the glucose for the glycolysis within the muscle itself. So please remember that this muscle glycogen, it provides the source of the glucose for the use of this one for the glycolysis within the muscle only, not any other tissues or the organs. Whereas the liver glycogen, it functions to store and export the glucose to maintain the blood glucose between the meals. This is the difference between the muscle glycogen and liver glycogen. Now, why the reason is that muscle glycogen is short of one enzyme, that is glucose 6-phosphatase. So it is the one reason, that's why it cannot move out of the muscle. And liver glycogen, it is considered as the first line of the defense in the decline of the blood glucose level. So any deficiency is there, or any other inherited problems are there, there will be the accumulation of the glycogen will be there, and this accumulation of the glycogen, it leads to some disorders like glycogen storage disease, or we can call other word Wernicke disease, liver disease, which will be dealt in the next classes. So by the appearance or occurrence of this glycogen storage disease, there will be the muscular weakness will be there, and if it is continued, the death may occur in those individuals. So the synthesis of the glycogen, it requires, one is the ATP molecule, UTP and glucose, and steps are there, in the four steps it is taking place, that is the UDP glucose formation requirement of the primer to start the glycogenesis, and glycogen synthesis by the glycogen synthase, and finally formation of the branches in the glycogen. These are the four steps which are involved in the synthesis of the glycogen. So it is the formation of the glycogen from the glucose. The pathway is that way. In the presence of this glucokinase, the glucose is converted into the glucose 6-phosphate. It is the glucose gets phosphorylation and forms into the glucose 6-phosphate. This glucose 6-phosphate is converted into the glucose 1-phosphate in the presence of phosphoglucomutase. This is the first one. And then what happens? Then it reacts with the UTP. This one, it reacts with the UTP and forms UTP glucosylating pyrophosphate. And this will be acted upon by the enzyme called UDP glucose pyrophosphorylase. So first one is similar to that one, whatever you find in the glycolysis process, where the glucose to glucose 6-phosphate, glucose 1-phosphate, and then the combination with the UTP, it will be converted into the UDP glucose pyrophosphorylase, that is in the presence of the enzyme called as UDP glucose pyrophosphorylase. And then later on, this, by the action of glycogen initiator synthase, the this one synthase, this UDP glucose, it forms a bond of the C1-4 linkage, or the bondage we call, that will be formed between one glycogen molecule, that is pre-existing molecule, that is called as the glycogenin. This glycogenin is formed from the tyrosine, where there will be the glycosination will be taken place between the glycogen and the tyrosine, and this glycogen primer will be formed. The presence of this one is necessary for the formation of alpha-1-4 bondage one. So because of this glycogen synthase, a new linkage, that is alpha-1-4 linkage, will be formed here, transferring the glucose from the UDP glucose, and then it is reducing to the transferring the glucose from the UDP glucose to the non-reducing end of the glycogen. That is, this UDP glucose, which combines with the glycogen primer, which is formed by the glycosylation of the one tyrosine and the glucose molecule, and this will get contact with this one, and in presence of glycogen synthase, it forms the linkage or the bond, glycosidic bond, that is alpha-1-4 linkage will be established. Once it is established, so what happens, this one, that is, it will be converted into the alpha-1-6 or alpha-4-6 bonds will be formed. This branching will be formed, and this branching can be formed from the glycosyl transferase, the another enzyme, because glycogen synthase, it will be responsible for the formation of the 1-4 linkage, that is forming in the form of the amylose, but it will be unable to form the linkage of 1-6 bondages. So for this purpose, the glycosyl transferase is needed one, which will convert that linkages, apart from 1-4 linkages, into the 1-6 linkage, or 4-6 alpha-1-6 bonds will be formed, and then later on the further branching will be taken place, and which you will find the formation of the glycogen. These branches, they go further and make it to the further branching of this one, and all these reactions, they are required to have two ATP molecules utilized, and ATP molecules will be required for the phosphorylation of the glucose, and another one to convert the UDP into the UTP. So remember well that this pathway is the one where there will be the consumption of the ATP will be there. So this is the difference between glycolysis and the glycogenesis. You remember, in that one there will be the yield of the ATP molecules. So you can see here, from the glucose 6-phosphate, 1-phosphate, and then there will be the UDP glucose will be formed with this enzyme, and then it is forming the alpha-1-4 glucosyl anidines, and as this cannot form the 1-6 glucosyl adding units, it has to get acted upon with the branching enzyme, or it is also called as the one enzyme, that is, the name is, just a minute, transferyl enzyme. We call that one as the transferyl enzyme. So that enzyme will lead to formation of the alpha-1-6 and glucosyl units, which will be the branched units of the glycogen. This is how the synthesis of glycogen takes place from the glucose. This is pathway which is yielding, taking into the account the ATP molecules, whereas in the glycolysis that will be one which will be yielding out the ATP molecules. Means this mode of the pathway or the reaction can be referred as the anabolic one, whereas the reactions related to the glycolysis is the one which is referred as the catabolic one. So today we have finished with the two things, that is gluconeogenesis and another one is glycogenesis. So these are the methods which are using for the consuming of the glucose which are needed for the proper functioning of the body. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, madam.